DG and DDG. Of course, I have been meeting my DDG quite often, Dr. Algu Sundaram, in various aspects. He has provided me a lot of money, because of which we have been in a position to do it. So, and of course, DG, I wanted to take him to IIT Kharagpur, if you remember, sir, for our ETI conference, international conference, but somehow the time did not match, so he could not go. But we would love to have you at IIT Kharagpur. In fact, our DDG also could not go. Well, sir, I can tell you one small thing, which I made a presentation which is exclusively for this, but it so happened that there is a problem here, so I had to just make shift a presentation. What I have done is I have put some videos of what the machines I have developed. In fact, I just wanted to say that all the four presentations in the morning I liked. But these are, in fact, have been in the process for last 10, 15 years. We know about it. I understand our one gentleman said that, well, these are informations are there, processes are there, which are being ERP and all that, those things are there. But what we need, as properly said by our chief guest today, as well as the DG, that we need for the farmers. So what we need, the technology, in fact, the hardware that we are interested in. Now, the hardware is a problem. We are talking of soil sensors. See, we have the soil sensor which can measure the moisture, but we want a online soil nutrient as well as moisture sensing device, which we can put in front of the tractor and find out, and accordingly we can do the needful of what we want to do in the soil. So whatever work we have done at IIT Kharagpur, I have not been in position to put everything, but I will try to tell you what we have done it through the videos which we have. Please, next one, please. Next. Okay, I did not say this thing because I wanted to show that what is mechanization going and all that. You can see that actually, you see the gap. So where we are needing more and more power. So, and this is what horsepower and tractor operation in India. Details are there. I don't think this is relevant here. These are the details of tractor trains in the world, in different selected countries. I would not like to talk about this detail because the context is something different here. This also is the tractor industry in India today. Now, image processing. I would like to say what we have done, and let me tell you that 1990, since computers were coming, and as a teacher, a young teacher, I wanted to learn. So what I did, I had attended a course of my.
Kindly stop murmuring. You like to talk, kindly go out and discuss and then come in. And here our job is to listen, and after the lecture you can interact, please.
Thank you, sir. So, I had learned image processing from my batchmate, in fact. I attended his class and learned. So, from that time, we wanted to introduce, and later on, we have also learned something about embedded system and about some sensors. So, I have learned, and then I have taught to my students, and then I'm still learning through them. So, what we have done through them, I am presenting here. Image processing, which way we have used image processing in our designs? Well, here we wanted, there is a problem in pineapple identification. So this work we did, that we wanted to find out what is the level of the ripening of a particular pineapple. So we did this work, and using that, see, these are the different steps by which we are in a position to find out. I can move that. These are the steps by which we will be in a position to find out what is the condition of the pineapple and whether we should harvest or not. Now these are the steps, algorithms which are written here. Now there was a video here. I don't think I can show you the video here. Here, this is another example in paddy. Many of you will be knowing. Now this is the type of disease which is there. So through image processing, we were in a position to know what is the this disease, and can we use a sensor by which we can go and spray at this location. So for this, we developed a device for a chemical application for taking care of this part. Then Yeah, this is the different stages of the image. Those who know about image processing, they will see that what from the original image to the image where we are having the actual image and comparing the images and then finding out the degree of infestation, DOI, which is given over here. So on this basis, then the amount of chemical can be spread. We have done this. Now you can see here details are given. We have written a GUI and through which we are in a position to say as to what is the stage of infestation, and then we are in a position to spray that. I don't know whether the video will run, but video I have asked this gentleman to put separately. So I will request you just please go through this separately. He will play all the videos that we have done. We have developed the machines. What I will show you is the hardware which we have done and which is working in the field. This is the one which has been done. It has been used in the field. I hope this has been also loaded. Then harvesting robots in agriculture. Actually, we have there is a problem of cotton pickup, so, cotton harvesting. So Mahindra wanted that, why didn't you do something related to this? So one of my students, we are also trying to do using robots, because difficulty is that in order to pick up the cotton balls, it's very difficult and it's very labor intensive operation. So we have made an attempt in this. We will show you the video of this also as to what we have done. These are the justification for this work. These are the actually problems and why we should have a cotton harvesting using robots. I need not go into details. These are obvious. Definitely we want that the because it is difficult and it is labor intensive, it is essential that we can do robots. But there is need that the robot should be in a position to be purchased by the person, or it should be a small robot. So what we are trying to attempt is a small technology, even for so that a small farmer can be in a position to purchase this. Now this is a big challenge. We have the technology, but the all questions which were directed was, can it will be in a position to help the farmer or not? That is the main thing. These are the steps which are required. In fact, what we have to do is take the image and we have to find out first whether the right kind of cotton is identified or not. Then only the you can see the steps which are given here. So there will be a manipulator which will try to identify, and then finding out the inverse kinematics. What it will do, it will find out the locations. Once it finds out the location, it will find out the XYZ coordinates of that particular location of the ball. And once it does that, the arm has to reach there in a certain measure. So once it goes XYZ, it will also like to go from what is the alpha, beta and gamma angles in each of these axes. So this is done through, inverse kinematics will give us the alpha, beta angles. And then once we know this thing, then the servometer will be given instruction, and then servometer will instruct this, and then it will be in a position to move and go to the ball and try to attract and collect it. Now this is the real image of that, and this is the image of that. What we have done is that we are in a position to see the cotton balls here. Three values we have given, and then what is the area here, what is the perimeter of all this. And then we have found out the centroid, because you can see that the shape, etc. So we have tried to find out centroid in two planes. And then the diameter of this, the largest diameter we have found out. Now these are the steps when we want to locate the particular cotton balls which are there in the field. Actually, this is from the field data. Now these are the steps what will happen actually. Initially, we'll take the image. After taking the image, we have to find out the XYZ planes. After that, we have to do inverse kinematics, find alpha, beta, and then it will be informed to the motor, servomotor, and the servomotor will inform this to the arm which is there, and it will go and do it. This is what explained in this particular system control. Now, this is what I was telling you here. You can see here that these alpha, beta, and all these angles which are given here, theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, theta 4, these are the angles given through this. In fact, this is through a GUI, where we want to know how much is the torque required, how much is the force required, and there will be a torque because it has to go at a certain angle. So how much is the torque required? So for that, You can see here that the maximum torque which have been found out, and what is the trajectory that it will for the arm, the actual end effector will follow. That trajectory is given over here. So this is the trajectory, and this is the value of the torque which will be required. You can see that motor 1, motor 2, motor 3 and motor 4. All these motors will be able to give the amount of torque, and accordingly then only that arm will be in a position to move and do it. This is there, I will show you in the video. Yes, so this is the one, possibly this video will not work, but he will be asked to, after I finish, then he will show you each and every video of that. I don't think this video will work here. Then drones, actually our DDG knows about it. Actually, what we are trying, see, drones are available. Any people have asked me questions, so many drones are available, what the hell you are doing? We are trying to get a drone of 50 meter radius, because I am targeting for a small farmer. So myself and a aeronautical professor and two young students we have taken, and we have developed this small variable payload of about 500 grams only. So the total weight of this is about 1.2 kg. And I will show you the video of this also. It has worked. Now we are in touch with one company in Agra, and we have told that we want to develop a robot for 50 meter radius only, because then you will not require the commercial licenses, etc. That is what I've been told, and that will be for a small farmer. If the farmer is sitting, then 50 meters it can go in any area, take the video, take the photograph. After it comes back, then we have analyzed the disease or analyzed the type of infestation which is there, and then the chemical is attached, camera is removed, and the chemical attached, and it will go there and then spray. Similarly, suppose it has to go about 50 meters on the hills, then it will be in a position to do it. So that is our target. Now they said that yes, it's a big challenge. The company fellow said that yes, it is a challenge. I said this is what we want. So we are targeting this robot as well as this drone for those small areas only. We do not, there are big robots available, 10, 20 lakhs, we are not interested in that. And we are quite hopeful of doing this. I will show you how this has worked. Our DDG has seen this thing, and in fact, he had agreed that he will give me 50 lakhs, and then we will be in a position to do it. Within next 6 months, we will be in a position to do it 2-3 of such, and have it tested at several locations. These are the details of what are the uses of this. I need not say, everybody knows about the details of drones and their capability of the drones, as well as their what are the requirements. These are the benefits that we give if you are aerial, several benefits. I need not go into details of this. Well, these are the process by which we are in a position to do it. What we will do, we have to locate the jeep through the GPS, the location of that particular location. After that, it has to take a camera. Now, we are not using a high spectral camera. We are using a very simple camera and see what to do. What is the level? Somebody was talking that he can identify the type of disease. This is becoming a difficult with us, I don't know. Maybe that I will talk to the IBM person. He was telling me, he was telling that it is possible. I knew from DG that there are 20 types of disease can come to a particular crop. So it is very difficult to identify. There was a question from this lady here that are different stages, because the items come at different stages. These diseases come at different stages. So it is very essential to identify those diseases at those steps and then take the action. So this is still a question mark. So this is what the image processing does, and then ultimately the job will be done by the camera. This is the drone. Okay, now I will show you the things which we have done. In fact, we have done for a sugarcane cutting, bud cutting machine also, because we have given a technology that sugarcane, instead of having those sets, yes, this is sugarcane bud cutting machine. This, in fact, this cuts about in 1 minute about 700 pieces will be created about in 1 hour. Yes, you can see here that through the image processing, the other details did not come, so I had to separate this for this presentation. Please excuse me, but I could show you. Yes, you can see this. This is through digital image processing. We have developed this, and this machine creates these buds only. And after these buds, we have developed a machine which is doing in the field. We have tested, and this machine has been developed in physical. I will show you that. The moment it identifies through this ultrasonic sensor, it is in a position to cut the just 30 millimeter those buds. Yeah, you can see here that here is this identification done, and accordingly it is cutting this. You can just see this. Next, next. Yes, this is that small drone that we had we have developed. We want to make multiple units of this, and we want to check it. Only 200 grams is the spray material which is given into this, and total weight of this is 1.2 kg. Total weight of this. Yeah. Next one. Yeah, actually we have also developed a ultrasonic sensor. There was a problem in MPKB Rahuri, and we were given this task. So what we have done, ultrasonic sensor, in fact the other video could not be loaded. We developed this in 2014, and then we went to with that device with the details of the solenoid and all the ultrasonic sensors which we had. We had taken it to Rahuri, we tested there, and they, on their suggestions, we came back, and after 6 months we went back, and that unit is developed. One manufacturer from Rahuri was interested, and what we have done, we have used the same thing which we have developed into another one which is commercially available. Now in this we have saved about 50% of the chemical. Now you can see here that wherever there is no there is a gap, it will not spare. It is not going to, you can just see that it is stopped. Only one side we are showing because we have tested here. The other unit is quite successful, which has been tested at MPKB Rahuri. Those who are there, they have seen, we have tested that part. That I could not show you here. Next one, please. Yes, this is the robot one. Yes, it has gone to that. So this is that location where the end effector will come and pick it up. Now one person from electronics department, one professor is there, and both of us were trying to do this. Yes. Next one, yeah, sugarcane one. Now sir, this machine we have already developed here, fertigation. So once the buds are cut, that we have developed here, that those buds can be kept, and then there is the ultrasonic sensor here, and you can see here that this is a spraying. After the buds are put, then we are fertigating there. So that is through the system here. You can see that wherever the buds are falling, this is this. This is the machine which we have designed, developed, fabricated at Agriculture Engineering Department, and we are testing in one of the farmers' field also. And we want to multiply these units and test it various locations. This is what we want to do it. Yeah. Yes, next one please, if there is anyone. Yeah. Yes. So actually one or two videos which were there which could not be tested. But then this is what I have to say. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. If you have any questions.
Thank you, Tiwari ji. Now I invite Dwivedi ji. He is from Department of Computer Science, Ambedkar University, Lucknow.
Very good afternoon to all of you. I thank the organizers for inviting me here. Unlike the previous presentation which I was listening, it's a pure academic presentation, but what I find that the area is very equally applicable to the agriculture field, as it is applicable in vast degree of areas. So if you listen it, you will find that you are most probably the agricultural scientist. So I may not be aware of the terminologies of agriculture, but as a common man I can say that cross-lingual information retrieval systems are nowadays in demand. And it all started with the launch of Google way back in 1997 when Google was launched. And I started working in this area since then. Since 1999 I started working with by exploring Google, which was in a very nascent stage at that time. The Google now nowadays that you see, Google is not the same, was not the same in fact that time. In fact, there was an incident when I was searching how this area became my area of interest. I was searching years back, 2002 or 1 or 2, about gate examination, and what I found to be lots of results listing in form of Bill Gates also. That means the Google at that time was not being able to understand what the query was, what the query is, and what the user's intention was. Second thing was at that time Google was not able to understand the other user's language. Other user's language means the Indian languages that came very late. Just 5 years back or 6 years back, very less number of persons were aware about whether search engines are capable of searching in Indian languages. Nowadays they are directly or indirectly capable. Few search engines which were developed by India, such as Guruji, Raftar, these were the search engines, is still unknown to many of you. They were purely Indian search engines, searching in Indian languages, especially Hindi language. Google has very recently launched many search engines in Indian languages. So what are the basically issues in this IR, information retrieval? Basically, there are three types of information retrieval. The first one is the one that we oftenly do. It is the monolingual information retrieval system that we use for our daily purpose. English query, English documents, Hindi query, Hindi documents, though it is rarely possible. Hindi query, Hindi documents, there are tools available. Then cross-language information retrieval is the one area in which I exactly work. And the area basically is you put a query in whatever language you like, and the results are displayed to you in the same language. That means your mother tongue. Or the query is in your own language and the results are searched by other from the world, all around the world, in all possible documents available, because you may not be literate in those languages, but the results will be searched in all those languages and results will be made available to you in your own mother tongue. That is the cross-language information retrieval, and that's why I said even agriculture field, this area is very, could be a very popular area. And multilingual information retrieval systems are just the extension of cross-language information retrieval system. That means a number of languages are involved here. Might be English, French, German, Bengali, Tamil. If these many languages are there, natural languages are there, then searching becomes a multi-language information retrieval system. And the common trends in web information retrieval are like web mining. We all do web mining, but what exactly are the researchers in web mining and how they are going to be benefited to the end user, all communities? There are basically three types of web mining. We usually do text mining, and then some other web mining which especially computer professionals do, like users mining. Users mining, the users log, the data log that a particular user has searched, that data log is stored on some server, and server is that data is analyzed statistically, and then better systems can be recommended. And based on this, recommender systems are also used. This can also be find in the very good application in the area of agriculture. Text classification is another area, very wide and popular area nowadays. And finally, cross language information retrieval system. So web mining has been talked about much, so I won't explore it. Recommender systems, though, I just have included one slide to show you that this is the current area of research, and all social networking sites are due to this recommender systems. You are being recommended by social networking sites about the friend suggestions. It is due to this type of research. And text classification is the another emerging area that provides basically summary. Huge number of or large number of documents are available in different languages, and those documents are collected from different sources. Especially, you might have seen the news summarization systems. News in different languages are available, and if you are not able to go through those news, you don't have time, you can use some text classification systems and finally text summarization system to get the final outcome of the news. That is in summarized format. So how exactly this CLIR systems work? You see, a user puts a query, maybe in English language, query gets translated in some other language. Other language is the target language. And web search is being performed, and the results are either directly placed to the user, or results are again translated into user's language and then placed to the user. If the results are directly placed to the user, it becomes a faster system. And if the results are translated into the original query language, that is Hindi in this case, it becomes a tedious process. But the final, the lowest line that I am referring to, the most effective system for the end users or the illiterate persons who are not literate in many languages, especially in India, where we have language diversity. And basically, there are three types of approaches that CLIR methods can be applied: query translation, document translation, and dual translation. Query translation means you translate only queries and leave the documents, the web document, as it is. And document translation means you translate documents into the query language. Don't translate query, translate document into the query language. And dual approach means translating document and query both. There are two issues or two ways of document translation: pre-document translation and post-document translation. In pre-document translation, what happens? All documents with respect to the query are already translated, so it saves time at the time of information retrieval system. And in post-document translation, what happens? This is the issue in pre-document translation, as I told you. In post-document translation, as also known as on-the-fly translation or as and when needed, this though is a better way, but it in some way it is again a tedious thing, because if a number of documents are there, large number of documents are there, this post document translation won't be a effective tool. And dual translation, translate queries as well as documents, if there are number of languages, natural languages in which the searching is or searching is required, then dual translation approach is the most effective approach. Also called number of application areas are there of cross language information retrieval. Though agriculture has not been there in this, but I think it is equally applicable as it is applicable in medical. Tools are there. Multimedia information retrieval systems are there. Video and question answering system is in demand nowadays. You ask a question to Google and Google replies. Just 2, 3, 4 years back, it was not happening with Google, the most popular search engine. But nowadays, at least text-based question answering systems and audio-based question answering systems are being heard and answered, but exact answer is not provided. That is the issue. List of links are provided, and you have to click those links and find the most relevant link. That was the issue. Then business, research and development, academics and otherwise. So if you are not known to many languages, you can still search those documents in your own language. That is the benefit. Education, a number of systems have been developed in cross-language information retrieval across world in many languages, both in India and abroad. You can see a number of languages are there: German, French, Russian, Spanish, and Portuguese. Then Mulinex is another system. I'm referring to most popular system which are available, especially not have been developed in India. Then Kaijai is another popular system developed in USA in many languages. Then you can see French, German, Spanish, and also in Hindi language. Now, what are the challenges in CLIR systems? We are going to pursue research in this area for the benefit of the end users. These are few of the common challenges that are still needs to be resolved. The first one is, you see, queries and documents are in different languages, the most common issue. Query is in, say, Hindi, document is in, say, French. So how to make a coordination between two? Both the languages have different structures. Morphological structure is different of that of Hindi and that of French language. Indian origin languages, which have the same script, such as Devanagari, may not have such issues, but the other languages whose scripts are different will definitely have problems in it. So this is the one on foremost challenging issue. Query ambiguity is the another problem. Means if you put a query, queries are usually 2, 3, 4 words long. And putting your intention behind the query just by putting 2, 3, 4 words is very difficult task. So, and the difficulty becomes even more when the words of the query are ambiguous. So in that, a large number of algorithms are there, which are known as WSD, Word Sense Disambiguation Algorithm. It's a different area of research in AI and NLP. So in order to make your query appropriate so that the search engine, which is after all a machine, so in order to make the machine understand your queries, you need to make the query in such a way that it should not be ambiguous. But what for a common man is not that literate, so he or she will put the query in his own language without knowing much about how the search engines are going to understand those queries. So what goes behind all search engines, they use some WSD algorithms to resolve those queries. And you might have seen Google often give this information, did you mean, like. So that is the kind of helping to you, improving the query with the help of you. Then queries are usually solved. In fact, very good research was carried out, and that was published in IEEE Transaction also a few years back, that usually queries are 2.3 words long. Any user who searches using a search engine or any IR system gives only 2 to 3 words query. So making the search engines understand just by giving 2-3 words your intentions is very difficult. Then document unavailability is another issue that is being solved by CLIR system by translating those documents. Then retrieval effectiveness is the most challenging task. All these, the first four things are responsible for retrieval effectiveness, and the terminology is known as relevancy of results. If the results are not relevant, no search engine or no IR or CLIR tool will be effective. So this is the issue. Then incorrect response of the query, that is sense problem, that has been there. And these are some prominent researchers who have done on various data sets. I have also listed some of the data sets. Machine translation is an integral part of CLIR systems. So unless you have a machine translation system, or unless you design your own machine translation systems, which translate from one natural language to another natural language, a Google Translator, Babylon, these are the examples of MT systems, no CLIR system will work. So that's why it is very important to know about MT approaches. A number of approaches are commonly followed in machine translation systems, like direct translation, rule-based translation, interlingual approaches, statistical based, one of the common methods. Then knowledge-based MT uses a number of resources, example-based translations, principle-based, then online interface system. These are some techniques of the machine translation system. And these are the systems developed in India for this machine translation in CDAC and one or two in IIT Mumbai. These are systems. Now, what is this back translation? Back translation is another helping tool, or can be a helping approach for CLIR system. A query translated in from one language, natural language, to another language, if it is translated back to the original language, then it is the process is known as back translation. What is the need of back translation? The simple need of back translation, as the example, this figure suggests, a Hindi query is translated into English and English query is translated back to English query. That means if you don't have reference translation available with you, you are doing a research in this area and reference translations are not available, then back translation would help you. And it also makes your process automated. Otherwise, human intervention or manual help would definitely be required. So back translation approach makes the translation process very. How to improve the relevancy of CLIR system? Unless the relevancy is improved, no CLIR system or IR system work. It is equally applicable. It was in fact equally applicable to Google. Google has improved a lot since last 10 years. Now, whatever you type onto Google, it easily understands, but the same was not true some 10 years back. Even people were usually fed up using Google search engine and switched the search engines rather than searching using the Google. But today it is not the same. What is query expansion basically? Most of the search engines and most of the IR systems use this technique, query expansion, to improve the result quality and ranking of the results. So suppose you have given a query and you retrieve a set of results. Say users usually see top 10 results, and among the top 10 results, user usually clicks first two or third results. Rest of the results, usually you are not interested. But have you ever seen Google list for every query, lakhs of results? So among lakhs of results, only few results are important. So how those lakhs of results are within few seconds or within fraction of seconds, those results are ranked. So to decide which results should come on the first page so that you can use it. It is the query expansion, one of the most popular technique to help those results on the top, along with the ranking algorithm. And you probably might be aware that Google's ranking algorithm, that is known as PageRank, and based on its founder, Lawrence Page. The PageRank algorithm is still known as one of the world's best ranking algorithm. And you can see how query expansion becomes very important. For example, a query in English, say Lal Bagh. You can have a number of interpretations from the same query. A Lal Bagh garden in Bangalore, Lal Bagh fort in Bengal, or Lal Bagh in Mumbai. Now, if the same query, Lal Bagh only, is placed onto the Google search engine, how the Google search engine or any search engine are going to interpret this query? Whether they will list the result corresponding to A, B, or C is a question. So, if the query is expanded based on the user's intentions, then the original query might either be A, might either be B, or might either be C. And now based on this expanded query, which is called query expansion, which is done internally, users, it is not visible to the user. So based on this expanded query, results are searched and final results are only placed to the user. Query expansion has two important, very important phases. One is the searching of most appropriate candidate terms to expand the original query. Means original query, say for example, Lal Bagh is the word that you have put onto the search engine. Now what are the other words which will make Lal Bagh understandable by the machine? These are called
Yes. Yeah. This is more fundamentally speaking.
Yeah.
We are very happy to hear from you what is the.
I have this.
Agriculture. We are more of application oriented scientists.
Case study later on.
Yeah, perhaps you will come so that.
Okay. So you can see dipped query is another issue. This is the case study that a system that I have developed along with my few research scholars in my university. This is a complete system of Hindi English cross language IR system, the CLIR system, in which all the terminology that I have explained for your before the this slide, the back translation have been used. Then we have used a Google Translator. Before using Google Translator, we use a number of translators to know which out of those translators can be helpful. So Google Babylon and some other translators have been used. So Google was found the most appropriate. Then we developed three data sets. FHIR, you might be it might be known to you. Forum for Information Retrieval System is the FHIR. FHIR is basically a data set that is a standard data set which is provided for the Asian language information retrieval systems. So Indian language plus Asian language. Then we have used Snippet as data set, another data set. Finally, we have used the nearest neighborhood as data set. The three data sets we have developed and tested our results. These are about FHIR data set.
Yes.
Then for query translation, we have used back translation approach. And these are the evaluation methodologies like precision, recall, F measure we have used for evaluating our system. The back translation approach that we have used using three translators, Google, Microsoft and Babylon, these are three standard translator systems. And you see, Google was found to be the best. If you see this table, correct translation and back translation, incorrect translation and back translation. Among these, the correct translation and back translation means correct translation and correct back translation. Google 84% and Microsoft 78% and Babylon 82%. And if you see the third, correct translation and incorrect back translation, only 10% of the queries were correctly translated by the translator but incorrectly translated by the back translator system. So Google, based on our results, Google was found to be the best among these. Now, what we did, we took 50 queries from the FHIR data sets. As I told you, FHIR is a standard data set. These are the 50 standard queries. So these were translated using a system that internally calls Google APIs and translates. Then these English translated queries are translated back into the Hindi query to know whether translations are correct. So if the translations are not correct, results will be affected. So we tested internally. So that through this we have been able to make our system automated. No human intervention was required in this system. So these are the 50 queries that we took for our research. Then we use a statistical method, OCAPI BM25.
How many slides? I think you have crossed already 25.
Okay. So I just conclude. Okay. So I use this algorithm for ranking the first retrieved result. It's a very popular ranking algorithm, among others, OCAPI algorithm. So after ranking, then we used this tool we have used, UML corpus tool we have used for data retrieval. And then finally, after using, you see results have been re-ranked after using OCAPI algorithm.
Yes.
And then we have used three data test data collections. How data collections are used, they have been created. You see the last column says that these are the terms to be added to the original query.
Yes.
These are second and third data collections that we have made. 25,000 words at the end.
You are a doctor? What is it? Divedi.
Divedi.
You are a good teacher. But we have crossed our learning age already. Most of us are 50 plus.
I think a message you got. I think audience would like to see the practicality, some initial.
This is a complete yeah. Developed system,
yeah,
in fact.
Kindly, everything needs to be discussed. Please.
So this is TSV. TSV is the method, term selection value, to use to select the final
yes.
term to be expanded.
Yes.
Then how TSV has been applied?
Perhaps you may conclude. See, all the mechanisms and formulas, perhaps, how many we can absorb these formulas? Perhaps you
no, I'm not, that's why I'm not explaining those formulas.
Yeah, please.
This is final expanded queries.
Yes.
The bold terms are the terms which have been added.
We are very happy. Some of the MG Narega, some of the things are there
yeah.
relevant to agriculture.
Yeah.
Please speak.
Queries are
yeah.
there related to agriculture also. Then finally, queries have been evaluated and the results
yes.
can be
Let us
placed.
Conclude. Let
yeah.
us
conclude. These are the results may not
yes.
be of much interest to you. Results. So finally, we results have been compared and we found that the TSV is
yes come to conclusion please.
Term selection value is an important approach for cross language information retrieval system
yes.
and that can be used to improve the cross language information retrieval systems
yes.
and it is applicable to all the areas including
yes.
your agriculture.
Agriculture.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Dwivedi, and now I invite Dr. Atul Negi is from Central University, Hyderabad, who would be speaking machine learning approaches and applications in precision agriculture.
So, good afternoon to everybody. This is the most difficult time to speak, and I have to recover some time from our previous speaker. So I'll proceed quickly, I suppose. I won't take too
yeah,
much time.
Please.
So I will first give some background, like I'm purely from pattern recognition and applications point of view. Techniques of pattern recognition and machine learning is really my domain, and I'm really grateful for all the organizers here to give me this opportunity to speak in something which is a bit different from my domain. Yes, sir. How do I proceed to the next slides?
Yes.
Okay. Right. So, so overview is that the background of the way where we are in machine learning and applications is from the long background of AI and expert systems. I request you to be slightly patient with me in that, because the where we are now it depends a lot on where we started from, so it's necessary to understand that. And then of course we will go on to machine learning, some present issue problems and some case studies which just in my recent researches, because of this talk, I could find something. So as we can see that reasoning is an important point of the AI systems, and the context of AI systems has to be based upon information technology. So information retrieval, storage, all those aspects. So. No, just from my experience, you cannot build a proper AI system unless you are strong with the information technology. Okay, so then just to understand, you know, what is it that is different about AI? So it is a branch of computing where there is some imprecision. Basically, if you see the this aspect, that is along two quadrants, along two axes. So the type of information, it's symbolic, and the kind of approach or the kind of processing is heuristic. So the intersection of symbolic versus heuristic is where it is really the domain of AI. So that is why it makes some of the making the AI systems to be a bit difficult, because heuristics are not always working, whereas algorithms will always work. Okay. So it is at the juncture of science and engineering, and of course these are various branches of AI, and expert systems is where a lot of work previously, not only it took place in agricultural domain as well. I think so lots of people here have produced those kind of systems. Here I wish to lay down an important point. There are two aspects which are very important for agriculture systems, and the bottom one is human computer interaction. So speech interfaces, vision interfaces, these are the aspects where we are working, and it's all very close to the domain of machine learning. Now essentially in machine learning the problem is that of knowledge acquisition. What do you mean by knowledge acquisition? Knowledge is different from data. So any input may be a data, but that input where there is a thought, there is a model, there is a refinement, that is going to be knowledge. Okay, so that is based upon your previous experience and things like that. Okay, so as we were talking to a lot of the scientists today, we have huge amount of data. In the agriculture domain, there is a huge amount of data. But do we really have properly labeled data? Okay, everybody says that I have 10 years data, I have 20 years data. But is the data labeled? So a corrected, properly labeled data, okay, that is the very basic requirement. And how many man-hours it takes to create that kind of data? So unless you make meta systems, you have to make a system which is going to help you to tag and correct that data. Okay, so that is something like a prerequisite kind of a thing. These are just to understand that, you know, what do you mean by the expert systems. So implicitly what we have done is that the knowledge of a person who has been in the domain has been captured and put into the system. Okay, whether you are building a machine learning system or whether you are building any other kind of a system, you know, this has to be done. So otherwise it will not produce the required output. So just to give a kind of a sketch, so what is important here is that, you know, we the inference is there, knowledge base is there, and learning module. So the learning module is the crucial aspect where your machine learning kind of things will be there, and the learned memories, you know, long term, short term kind of things have to be stored in that. All AI ML learning algorithms work with just a long term memory, but we also as human beings have what is called a short term memory. So if you are really trying to have a context, sometimes a short term context may be there. So like that, you know, learning systems are to be built. Okay, many case studies are there. I think so there's not much of my talking about these kind of things. You people are all aware of these kind of things, so I won't show. But after saying everything good about AI expert systems, what happened? The expert systems failed. So they failed because there are high expectations and, you know, all such things. So the expert systems failed. But what was that failure attributed to? Okay, because of these reasons. That is, the knowledge base wasn't really very solid. Like I said, the labeling of the data and making knowledge was not good enough. The knowledge base was too narrow. It was only about one small particular thing. So it could not generalize. It could not be used for another kind of thing. Once you go into meta knowledge, rules, you know, so then it's an infinite chain. You cannot come out of that. So, and the knowledge acquisition was too difficult. So there are the domains where, you know, the expert systems mistakes could not be tolerated. So this is where we could not use the expert systems, and then we had to come up with the machine learning approaches where if you want to contribute and bring out a machine learning approach, we need to think of, there are some problems where we can use supervised approaches, In supervised approaches, the assumption is that you have labeled data. Labeled data meaning that the tagging or the ground truthing, whatever you would like to call it. Okay, so if you have that, then these are some of the approaches which are there. And to get something successful result, we need to, you know, choose an appropriate tool. So all I'm saying is that these are the left side is the things where you'd be able to choose something appropriate as your to get your machine learning result. However, previous to machine learning, that is, you have some large kind of data and you don't have some class labels for that. What do you do with that? So it is like a precursor, you know. So you need to apply what is called as exploratory data analysis. So that is the unsupervised approaches like clustering, and sometimes we need to remove those aspects of the data which are not required. See, today morning when people are talking about data lake and data ocean and all those kind of things, sometimes I felt really a bit nervous and say that, do you really need to store all that data? Okay, so people are going towards data lake and ocean and all that because they haven't really figured out that what is the really the crucial aspect of the data they want to store. So there is, in my opinion, there shouldn't be an approach where you are blindly storing huge amounts of data without the disk capacities and storage densities may be going on increasing, but still somewhere you want to process it. So I feel that, you know, let us not accumulate a data junk as well. Okay, so data lake and ocean aside, let us not create a data cesspool, if I want to follow that analogy. Okay, so how do you analyze? So the problems with very large kind of data come from the dimensionality aspects. A lot of the machine learning approaches will not give you the correct result if your number of attributes is too high. How do you remove the number of attributes? For that, you have to do the dimensionality reduction and PCA methods, where I have worked on quite a few of my publications are in the PCA methods. That is called as principal component analysis methods. Is similar to the singular value decomposition approaches. Okay, so these are things where, you know, here I'm not enumerating all the methods, just a quick sketch. Okay, now that we know which are these methods, where is it, what could be applicable, what is going on in the practice. So this kind of a split up pie chart is telling you that where and how which kind of approaches have been used and which are there. Okay, one thing which looks a bit which I would like to give a point here is that if you look at classification accuracies, the one which is in a dark blue, I think you can see that. So that is attributed to the random forest. You take any kind of a problem and if you look at classification accuracies, those people who have worked with random forests will tell you that you can get very high accuracy with the random forest model. Okay, so but it is not much used. Okay, however, as you can see, most of these a lot of is going with the support vector machine and with this kind of nearest neighbor approaches and all that, which are very neural network approaches. Nearest neighbor approaches are also very good and significant because they are very fast to set up. Okay, so there is no training really required much, you know, so that way. So these are just to give some, you know, a practitioner's viewpoint that, you know, which machine learning approach to take up. But then whatever we were doing with respect to the machine learning for the image results, there were a lot of problems. And this graph shows that there was a revolution which came about because of bringing in deep learning. So that is, as you can see, the lower curve is showing how the earlier machine learning approaches are saturating, whereas the curve for deep learning is going on and increasing. And In many image processing problems, it is close to the, very close to the human performance of 94 or 96% of accuracy. So that is how the things are. However, there are limitations also with deep learning. So just, you know, as a thing that, you know, why is it that our machine learning approaches were failing and this deep learning approaches were succeeding? It is because of a simple thing. Earlier, what we were doing is that we as researchers, we were finding out the features and we were trying to do the manual feature extraction, which is shown here. And it so turned out that the features which humans were extracting were a bit different. And once we said that, okay, let the data tell the story. So once the data is telling the story, so then the feature extraction layers into the neural networks are incorporated in the beginning. And through that, only those features which are surviving the feature extraction stages are coming through to the classification stages. Okay, so therefore their outcomes really improved. So here we have, if somebody is really interested to dive deep into these things, so you have this survey on that, and this is one of the newest things which is there, which is called as the generative adversarial networks. So this is where a totally new approach has come up, where the idea is that this is trying to overcome one of the difficulties which is there with deep learning. So here the training and all takes place in such a way that some kind of false images are generated, and those images are shown to the discriminator, and through that the ones which are so the output result, and that is seen, and it gives a deeper feedback to the learning. So this is one of the recent developments in the deep learning approaches, and whoever is working on this, in fact there is a lot being done in this right now. There are so many things which are there beyond this, which I will, which, you know, it takes too much time to explain. Yes. So there is something like one shot learning. So in one shot learning, the advantage is that you don't have to really do too many training cycles and things like that. Okay, so now I'll just quickly conclude with some of the precision agriculture kind of things, which is only two things. One is that their application in the crop protection, and there is also for the crop yield prediction and these kind of things. I'm sure all of you will be really immersed totally in deep learning and those kind of activities. Okay, so I'm just showing, and I'm not talking about it. Okay, I've shown the reference. It's there in my presentation. Everybody can have this presentation, and we can go deep into that. Okay, so people talked about their company. I'm talking about myself.
Yeah.
So you can see this.
Related to precision agriculture and machine.
Yes,
learning.
Yes, yes. So this just.
This audience would like to have that machine learning relationship, agriculture
precision. Yeah. So here. It's just, this is my Google Scholar page.
Yes, yes.
And with that I am done. Okay. If required, there is a some aspects are there about these kind of things which are done with a new colleague of our who has joined our university. He has worked in this WSN and things like that. Okay, so with that I will conclude here. Please, you can look up my page on the Google Scholar, and that will give you the range of my research which I have done, which is related to pattern recognition, wireless sensor networks, etc. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Atul Negi. And I invite all the three speakers to the dais for taking up some of the discussion. Dr. Tivari, Dr. Tivedi, and Dr. Negi is already here. Wow. there are the three presentations. Basically, first one was AI and its application in precision agriculture, reference to drone technology. Second one is a cross language information retrieval. Third one is a machine learning approaches in precision agriculture. So we'd like I'd like to invite some of the three sessions, and we will be having another 10 minutes, 10 to 15 minutes maximum, and both our speakers will be addressing those concerns. Yes, Dr. Ambas.
My question is with Dr. Nidhi.
Yes,
when you said machine learning and the deep learning,
yes,
are you mean to deep learning is the part of the ANN and the multi-layer perceptrons or something
different? Yes, yes. Yes, it is the case. Yes.
So one single node is the normal machine learning. If there is a one weight in the ANN.
Actually, there are in deep learning. Why is it called deep? It is called deep because there are deeper layers of networks. So typical perceptron problem, three-layer perceptron, it does a good classification job. But the feature learning is not there. So for deep learning, we will include one more set of networks, which will be doing the feature extraction, okay? And then that will pass on the information to the classification layers, where the entire process of training is like your multi-layer perceptron with the kind of feed forward network and back propagation, error back propagation. There are kind of architectural differences and all minor differences with respect to deep learning. I can share with you. Often.
Yes. Yes, sir. Dr. Now,
my question is to Dr. Professor Dwivedi. Professor Dwivedi ji, aap CLRA ke baare mein keh rahe the, and whether is there any product which you have developed for that from directly English to Hindi conversation? If that product is useful, then that can be utilized for the benefit of farmers in the way the agro-med advisories, whichever we are developing, that can be directly linked to that, so that the farmer cannot be in confusion. That can be directly given him in Hindi language.
Yeah.
That is my suggestion.
In fact, through my presentation also, I highlighted that Hindi IR system, the prototype of Hindi IR system has been developed. It was also a project funded by the Government of India that has been completed. A prototype has been developed. They use Google APIs for retrieving the English documents from Google. And then about the CLIR system, it is...
Sir, my question is directly, if there is any standalone kind of package you have developed...
That's what I am telling
you. Yeah,
please. CLIR system is being developed right now. The model has been ready. A system is being developed. Prototype we have tested already.
Okay.
My question is to...
I am
Samuel
Kumar. Yeah.
My question is to Dr. Tiwari. You have shown some videos...
Can you come to near mic? The
systems are built based on the... What are the technologies, what are the languages, programming tools, the packages that you have used for the... So, some data on the
Can you repeat that? Can you repeat shortly that?
We have shown some systems which are basically on computer vision. So what are all the technologies, programming languages and existing packages that we have used?
Yeah, Python is the language used. Python is the language used, and the GUI has been used through MATLAB 2014 B.
Yes, Nagarjan. 1 minute.
So my question is, Dr. D.K. Tiwari, sir, so regarding identification of cotton balls, so have you taken care about the cotton balls are different sizes? So how have you fixed any size for the cotton balls and taken care for the different cotton balls identification?
Yeah.
How much time it takes for each cotton ball?
Well, it's a good question. In fact, we have not done that part of it. We've seen that
So what we have done is we have found out the different details of that, and those details include the centroid and the total diameter of that. So the end effector will go and catch, it will have a range of its movement, range of its movement through the alpha, beta, gamma, which are the inverse kinematics through which they will be able to develop the moment it identifies X, Y, Z.
Thank you. Yes. Yes, one minute.
My question is to Professor Tiwari, sir.
So
actually, you have told that you have been developing some small-scale drone technology.
Yeah.
So what are the prices of the commercially available drones, and what are the prices of the drones which you are small-scale drones you have been developing, and what are the exact advantages of these drone-based images in comparison to remote sensing images?
Okay. See, let me tell you that the first one which we have developed is the one which I have shown it to you. DDG is not here. In fact, we did with whatever money we had, okay, from other projects. And he has promised that he will give us so that we can make a couple of copies of this unit which we have developed at IIT Kharagpur in consultation with the Aeronautical Engineering Department, okay. The cost, etc., we are not looking into, but my idea will be that it should be within 1 lakh rupees. Within 1 lakh rupees. This is my the maximum I'm thinking of. Because my aim is that if we develop a drone which can do a job within 50 meter radius. That is the aim.
Yes.
Commercially available drones are several bigger sizes, 10 lakhs, 15 lakhs, 20 lakhs drones are available. Oh, they are available.
Yes. Please.
With multi-spectral, hyper-spectral camera
got,
and all
he
that.
He got it. Yes, please.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't really assume that the licensing is wrong.
No.
So, in that situation, what would be the payload it can tell you how much?
That's what I said. Because the payload will be very, we are not going to have more than 750 grams. This I showed you is about 400 grams.
Yeah. So.
And it will be a variable one. So once it will carry a camera, do the job, and we will analyze. Then it will go with the same location with the simple camera and the sprayer. So the load will be varying at that time. This is what we have created the concept. No, but I do not want that. No, the moment I talk of 4 kg, it will cost about 5 lakh rupees. I have, we have tried all those things. The moment you talk of the heavy payload, the moment it comes, see, the whole cost of the structure is about 2.5 kg. And the moment I put 1 kg, so it is about 3.5 kg.
Yes.
3.5 kg, 4 kg will be more than 5 lakh, 6 lakh rupees. So that's why we want to have.
Yes.
And
yes.
Moreover, just a second. Moreover, wherever we want to find out, identify wherever the infestation has taken place. So there it will go, come back, and it can do the job within that 50 meter radius.
Yeah.
That
so,
Krishna Reddy.
The experts is now failed. I guess all of you go now. In 1970s, I'm a database researcher. Expert system showed a lot of promise. By 1975, billions of dollars invested by America on expert systems, and it failed. Later on, you know that DBMS technology, SQL technology saved entire computer industry. Now also similar thing is happening now.
That Reddy, your question is addressing to
addressing
Negi. Yeah,
Negi only. So do you think that similar thing is happening? The point is that how much promise AI is showing. We should be very optimistic or pessimistic. What should be the our strategy now? We should not completely, we should depend on AI to solve our problems, or we should be cautious.
So sometimes what happens is that if it works, it is not AI.
Okay.
So this kind of thing is also going on.
Okay.
But we can be pragmatic. See, lot of computer vision and image processing problems have been solved with the deep learning and AI approaches. It's not because of shortage of time, I am not giving the total, so many industry problems. So like any optimization problem formulated and solved as deep learning problem, immense number of solutions to industry are also.
Yeah. from CIA.
Yes, I have a comment on what Dr. Tiwari and Dr. Negi said, and one question. First, I will ask one question to Dr. Trivedi. When we talk of this language databases, who is maintaining these databases?
Language databases?
Yeah. So when you see, when translation is taking place, so there must be some database someplace. Ah. So who is maintaining these databases and who is enriching it? I'm asking that in the context that when we are talking of agriculture and dealing with the farmers, so not only language comes into picture, but dialects also come into picture. Mm. And then there are so many slangs, mm. local names for certain crops, certain machines, certain practices. So how can we take care of these things? That is my question to you. And then I will come to my comment later.
In fact, what we did in our research, we maintain our own database. Bilingual corpuses are available. WordNet is available, which is widely used for NLP applications. IndoWordNet is available, which has been developed by IIT Mumbai for Hindi and other Indian languages. So likewise, specialized data, as you are talking about for agriculture domain, can be developed and maintained.
You mean it has to be developed?
Yeah.
Okay. Now my comment related to Dr. Negi and Dr. Tiwari is that we cannot talk of only machine vision in isolation. You see, vision may be most powerful sense, but we cannot talk of it in isolation, and that may be, and we are here talking about artificial intelligence. So when we are looking at something, even the spectral data that is coming out, many of the people, agricultural domain people, they know that if you give urea, then your crop becomes more green. So that doesn't mean that that greenness is related to some other feature. So we have to see it in a holistic manner. We have to see other features also. We have to take care of other features also. Then only this intelligence. So we need to make it intelligent. And we need to see that how a experienced scientist, in the first session what was happening is, whatever their presentation, they were very good. But experienced people of experience were not associated. So a person's experience, this is a challenge for computer science people, that a person's experience, how to translate it to it in a objective manner and into some kind of protocol. That is one of the biggest challenge.
Yeah.
In short, my answer is that when I said that we should not accumulate and take all the features or attributes, so we must use a dimensionality reduction. So in the dimensionality reduction, you know, there is a huge number of attributes. Some of them are nonsense attributes, some of them are not relevant attributes. So when we do our pre-analysis, we will remove those attributes which are not going to be relevant. And anyway, in the deep learning approaches, those attributes which are not contributing correctly to the classification, they will be automatically getting suppressed. So that's how it will be taken.
Yes.
I'll just add here.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think you have a point, but what we have one computer science person, a professor who is also looking into this part, because we know that this is a problem of identifying. In fact, I have also worked on the weeders, because the green weed as well as the plant, both are there. So in fact, we are taking data of various kinds of diseases, which are disease infected in different crops, and then the computer person is trying to identify that. So we have taken care of this. We know that this problem will be there. This is the difficult part of the problem which we are trying to identify. Thank you.
Yeah, Pradeep.
This is related to Dr. Negi's presentation. So from your presentation, it is evident that whenever we are dealing with any heuristic system, so probability is an inbuilt thing in that. So yes, that means artificial intelligence for everything, we cannot expect it to be 100% sure. So that needs to be taken into account, and there will be a probability where it will be more and or it will be less. So based on the system and based on wherever it is, biological system is more active, their probability may be, we may expect lesser success.
Yeah.
And wherever it is, say, physical and other attributes are more involved, then we may expect a better quality.
Yeah, it is
so
only
that
for
has to be taken.
It was only for consideration that what.
Yeah, as a point, for something as important as a human life, the medical expert accuracy is only 60%. With deep learning for the MRI scans and images, they made it to 75% and 80%. So that's the probability aspect is there, definitely is there.
Let us home.
Sir, I'm S.K. Soom from NAM. First of all, thanks for the wonderful presentation and also the wonderful work. I have, sir, just two clarifications. First is that, have you taken the patents, the design patents for these inventions, what you have done?
Oh, yes.
And then second is, for example, you showed that sugar
butt cutting machine.
Why did you choose this?
Oh.
And when you took up this project, did you compare that?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, so many things
mm-hmm.
are there,
yeah.
and it is the one which yeah. is, which has to be taken.
Yeah.
Because, what was that?
Oh,
in your
yes,
mind
in fact. Yeah, in fact, this is we have done all the different statistics of how much which aspect is coming into picture, particularly for sugarcane. Sugarcane planters have a big problem. You have to carry the so much of big stock. Then sugarcane for planting, so much of intensive labor is required, and this aspect of the buds is picking up. So we thought, why not automate, because cutting is also a problem. So we used ultrasonic sensor based machine for cutting of this at a very faster rate. And once it is cut, it is just now a seed. And that for that we have made the machine and we have tested. The machine which I said is a design developed and fabricated and working at IIT Kharagpur. This which I said. And it is doing the job. So we have solved this problem. We have solved this problem. Because we have gone into all details of the economics of this, then only we have gone.
Yeah, patents have been taken up and it was decided it is a very prevalent problem. That's why. Any question? Last one? Any? Yes.
My question is to Tiwari, sir. Sir, identification of disease through image processing, you have shown it. So can we identify the disease? Particular disease of a crop which have similar images or similar structure?
Oh yes, that is what it is, that in different crops there will be different types of infestation. This is infestation which will take place.
In only one crop, but different disease, but the structure is similar to the one.
Well, yes, it will do it, but then as you are trying to put the question in such a way that if it is similar, yes. It will have to be, we have to take a lot of data to identify that it doesn't identify the particular type of one disease and the other disease. We have to take a lot of data for this, doing this. We have to train our system for that. Yes?
Thank you very much for all the three speakers. In fact, it is a very learning experience. And friends, you have listened morning how the software private companies have made presentations, and now the second group is that academicia and the professors have spoken. And but issue morning, as Dr. DG Saab was telling, that agriculture is not that much easy to interpret and to take the ground level realities. He says that complex, you need to spell 10 times, so complex a system. So it's very difficult. At the same time, of course, technology has to contribute. And Dr. Tiwari spoke about the disease management. Of course, not only diseases, various diseases, pest sucking pests, and also nutrient deficiencies, also drought. In fact, water deficiency conditions, that again another complexities look like some of the drying. So more you see that, more the complications, and then we need to be very, very updation is required. And cotton robotics, of course, he has explained very well. In fact, we have experience of lot of cotton. Cotton is considered as a white gold, and but because of labor shortage, in many cases we are seeing that cotton is left in the fields. So important aspect. And drones and these things, of course, I could not see whether really buds are protectively cut, or perhaps you need to refine that mission. And second one is, topic approach is very, very important, especially compared to Chinese agriculture, any other language. You see, we have number of languages, more than 1500 languages, somebody was telling about. So when this grass learning information retrieval system really works, it will be really useful for our extension system. And for example, Dr. A.V.M. Subbarao was telling that contingency bulletins, if we are made, they were making, if it really translated English, English is made and put in ICR website or some website. If it is really, the system works, we go at least 15 or 18 languages, national languages, immediately it will be useful. But what he suggested was that at present the success is he has come out to protocol level. Perhaps we would like to see more light, more practical utilization at the ground level. The third presentation is machine learning for precision agriculture, and I was very, very eager to see that where is precision agriculture and machine learning contributions. The important point is said that where large mining of data is available, as morning Madam Nandini was telling, but he says that we should be very, very careful about oceans, and he was using data lakes, data oceans, need to be very, very careful. But he was telling that labeled data is very, very important for these issues. And these are the three presentations. Thank you very much. And out of these, our reporter Ranjit is making. And if you want any some clarifications to bring out. And also, I would like all the three speakers for giving, as morning session was ended, 1, 2, 3 key lessons out of this, a practical aspects of precision, how it is contributing to it. Would be very, very appreciative to bring out some of the recommendations for entire 2-day national workshop. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Before we end the session, I request our chairman to please facilitate the speakers with the mementos. Our first speaker is Professor V.K. Tiwari.
पे सुनो माइक लगा कान पे हेडफोन लगा मैं बोल रहा हूँ आ रही है हमें हम
हेलो हेलो चेक हेलो 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 चेक माइक माइक चेक
हाँ ये तो है
हेलो हेलो हेलो
अरे ओ जीतू जाए पिया कौन जा रहा तू इसके साथ है इसके चक्कर अब फंस रहा है इसके साथ ऑफिस आ रहा है या जा रहा है कहाँ की करे इसके चक्कर में इसके साथ पैदा तू ना आया जो भाई तू इसका नहीं तेरा बात को पता रुक जाएगा तेरा वहाँ खड़ा होना इसका यहाँ बैठना तेरे गेम खेलने तो ना कैमरे पे खेलना मैं बोला वही रखू यार नहीं है यार कुछ है नहीं ऑडियो सिस्टम का
हेलो हेलो चेक